Hello, Peaky Board Gamers, and welcome to another Peaky Board Gamer episode. My name is Hector Rakos, and in today's video... Well, all I'm gonna say is that this video contains hardcore rule explanation, and if you're not up to it, maybe it's better if you watched another video of this channel. However, if you don't feel threatened by what I've just said, and I really hope you didn't, join me at the table and let's see how Kanban EV is played. At first, place the board in the middle of the table, which depicts a car manufacturing facility. Place the car parts at one side of the board, choose three different car parts at random, and place them to the corresponding spaces in recycling. Create a supply with the parts vouchers and the books next to the board. These 12 tiles are the factory goals and are split to three categories. After you shuffle them, you only need two tiles from each category and the rest are returned to the box. The tiles from these two categories are placed here on the board. All the tiles depict a number of icons on their left side. After you place them, make sure that the tiles with the fewer icons are placed above the others in each one of the categories. Finally, place two generic speech tokens on each one of the tiles. This is just for the four players game. In a three player game, you need that many speech tokens, and in a two player game, you need only one token on each tile. These two factory goals depict a number and are placed to their corresponding spaces here on the board. Also place two generic speech tokens in these two tiles. Again here you should place less speech tokens if you play with less than four players. The facility is split to five departments. Let's start with research and development setup first. You should cover the test track with this board depicting your player count 3 or 2 players. If however this is a 4 player game, this board stays in the box. Place the meeting marker and the production cycle marker in the indicated spaces and the pace car to either one of the two striped spaces, however it should be pointing to a counterclockwise direction. Finally place the 6 car part value markers here. One of the two sides depicts a stripe beneath the icon. You need the other side face up. Next, let's move to design setup. These are design tiles. After you shuffle them, place one of them face up in these 8 spaces on the board. With the rest, create 3 stacks of 9 tiles and place them in these indicated spaces, again face up. Now let's move to assembly setup. First, place the car tray next to the board. Then for each car color, place one car to the corresponding colored space on the board and then a second one to the space to its left. Then shuffle the demand tiles, choose 2 at random, and place them in these spaces here. Then place speech tokens next to these spaces, as indicated on these tiles. The rest of the demand tiles are placed in a face-down stack next to the board. For the logistics setup, all you need is the order cards, which you should shuffle and place them in a face-down stack next to the board. Then flip the top card face-up. Then find the depicted car parts and place them in the corresponding warehouse spaces on the board. Finally, place this card face down in the bottom of the stack. Now let's move to administration setup. Here you need the performance goal cards, which again you should shuffle and place them in a face down stack next to the board. Then place the top 4 cards face up in the indicated spaces on the board. Then place the weak marker on the spot and finally, after you shuffle the final gold tiles, choose one at random and place it here. Now I would like you to meet Sandra, the factory manager, and this tile simulates her attitude. If you're playing the normal game, then Sandra is mean and you should use the red side face up in this tile placed here and Sandra sitting in her office. Let's move to player setup. Each player selects one of the colors and gets the personal board as well as the tray with the components of the corresponding color. First, players need to place their garage bonus tiles face up in their garages. One of these tiles depicts a locker and this one must go to the last space. How the rest are distributed is not important. Then players place a double upgrade tile in this spot with the locker facing upwards. Now players use 5 locker components and place them to all spaces on the board indicated with a red locker. Players place one of their personal speech markers in this space here. Players start the game with a parts voucher which is placed here, 3 performance goal cards and to order cards, all these taken from their corresponding supplies. These here are our word tiles. After you shuffle them, you randomly place three face down to the indicated department spaces and you return the rest back in the box. If you're playing with less than four players, use two award tiles instead. Then you place one speech token in the top of each award tile stack. And then you place one of each player's disc marker to each department in the indicated space marked with an X. Players place their last disc marker to space 15 of the production points track. Players also place their banked shift markers to space 0 of the shift track. The general setup is now complete. However, the game starts with a short employee orientation process with which the players differentiate in how they start the game. Players now randomly choose one of the players to be the starting player. The rest players follow in a clockwise order. Using this order, players place their certification marker to one of these four spaces, and they collect immediately the bonus depicted on that space. A move for the banked shift marker, a book, a parts voucher, or nothing at all. Now, using certification player turn order from right to left, players take an available car part from logistics and place it in an empty space in their personal board. Players also take a design tile from the design area and place it to any empty space on their personal board. This tile could be also the top tile from one of the stacks. As we will see, these four tiles also grant the player one bonus. At this point, this bonus is not granted. After the player takes a car part and the design, without replenishing the empty spaces, the next player takes his orientation turn. After all players have taken an orientation turn, shift all designs to the right and then replenish them from their corresponding stacks from right to left. In Kanban, players are employees in an electric vehicle factory. During the game, players will be using their shifts to perform various tasks in many different departments. Moreover, they'll be attending meetings, receiving trainings, and they will be evaluated by Sandra, the factory manager, which is an automated character with a specific attitude towards the players. So who will be the most valuable employee of the company? The player that has accumulated the most production points by the end of the game. The game is played over a series of rounds until the game's end is triggered. We'll see how later on. Each round consists of two phases. Phase 1 is department selection phase, where players place their pawn in one of 10 workspaces on the board. There are 5 different departments in the factory, each department has 2 workspaces. In the first round of the game, players will be placing their pawns using the certification marker order from right to left. So the purple player goes first, followed by the yellow player, then the orange player, and finally the blue player. In subsequent rounds though, the player order of this procedure will be determined by the player's pawn location. This order works from top to bottom, so in round 2, the blue player will have to choose his next workspace first. The factory is using an employee rotation policy. No player may stay in the same department for a second round in a row. So the blue player has to change department and find a workspace which is vacant. Then the orange player has to choose next, then the purple has to choose next, and the yellow player has to choose last. Sandra, the factory manager, also moves as well in this phase. In the first round, however, she remains in her office. She will move for first time in the second round, and as she is in the bottom, she will move last after all players have moved first. When Sandra leaves her office, she scans from top to bottom to find the first empty workspace. Like the other players in subsequent rounds, Sandra has to leave the department and checks the next one for an empty workspace. If there is a vacant workspace, she moves there. If, however, she would have to move to a department that is full, then she skips that department and goes to the next one that has an empty workspace. If, however, this department is administration, then instead she moves to her office. She never takes a workspace in administration. And from the next round, she will start again, moving from top to bottom. We've seen now how the first phase works in the first round and in subsequent rounds of the game. After the first phase, the round proceeds with the work phase. In the work phase, players take turns again from top to bottom, using shifts provided by the chosen workspace to perform tasks in the linked department. The workspace depicts the number of shifts the player has available to perform various tasks in the department. The player may also use his banked shifts to increase this number to a maximum 4. This symbol next to each department task is the number of shifts required to perform this task. After a player has used up all his shifts, he lays down his worker so that the next player can take his turn. Each department has a green training area with player markers that move on a track. These markers show the amount of training each player has received in this specific department. We will talk about training a bit later, however. When it is Sandra's turn, she will be evaluating the player or players that have received the least training in this specific department. We will talk about Sandra's evaluations later on as well. After all players have worked their shifts, they check to see if there is a meeting or if it is the end of the week, because this will trigger some procedures that I will soon explain, and then the next day begins. Before going through the department tasks, I will explain a couple of general rules. During the game and through various bonuses, players will be acquiring part vouchers, books, and shifts. Players may only make use of what they have at the beginning of their turn. What they gain during their turn cannot be used until their next turn. When the player gains books or part vouchers, the player places them next to his board, and at the end of his turn, he brings them on his player board so that he may use them on his next turn. Also, when the player gains shifts, he may use this token to remember how many shifts he had at the start of his turn. Now, last but not least, whenever a player gains a generic speech token from the board, he returns it to the supply, and he places a personal token on his board. Now, when the player gains another general speech token but cannot place another personal one on his board, then he leaves the generic speech token next to his board for later use. Now let's talk about training. All departments have a task that relates to training. When performed by a player, the player moves his training marker one space forward. If the new space is occupied by other players' markers, then place the marker in the top of the stack. Also, at the start or at the end of his turn, a player may use as many of his books and move his marker one space for each book used. As soon as the player's marker passes this point, then the player becomes certified for this department. Each time a player gets certified in a department, he unlocks an element by removing the locker from his board. Then the player moves his certification marker to any empty space of the next level, receiving the depicted bonus immediately. If there is a factory goal at this level, the player gains a generic speech token. If the player takes the last generic speech token from the goal, then the goal is removed from the game. Also, tasks depicting this icon are locked initially and can only be performed by certified players. After becoming certified, a player may continue receiving training to reach this point and become an expert. The first player that becomes an expert gains the generic speech token. Also, players becoming experts choose one of the available award tiles secretly, gain the bonus immediately, and return the tile to the box. The rest tiles remain on the board. Let's now explain department tasks, starting with design. With this task, the player chooses one of the 8 rightmost tiles on the board and places it in an empty space of his personal board. If he has no empty spaces, then he cannot perform the action. The task costs 1 shift and can be performed multiple times, but without replenishing the tiles. The 4 rightmost tiles are connected to an instant bonus that the player gains immediately each time he collects one of these designs. So if the player gets this design, he gets a shift, and if he gets this design, he will get a book, and if he gets this design, he will get another book. When the player finishes spending shifts, he slides the tiles to the right and then replenishes the empty spaces with tiles from the corresponding stacks from right to left. If there are no tiles left to replenish all the spaces, these spaces are replenished from the central stack. Getting certified in the design department unlocks a fifth design space on the player's board, but also enables the player to perform this task as well. The only difference with a normal task is that the player may also choose the top tile from these stacks as well. If the player picks the last design from a stack, then this space is immediately replenished from the central stack. Let's continue with logistics department and the task issue a Kanban order. As this multiplier indicates, this task may only be performed once on a player's turn. First, the player gains a banked shift, and then he plays one of his Kanban order cards in this space here, either up or down or the other way around. Now, where this gray line crosses the card is very important, because car parts from the card will be moved to the corresponding warehouses if both the icon and the warehouse is at the same side of the line. Look in my graphics how placement of this card affects replenishment of the warehouses. The car parts are moved to the warehouses, the player then discards this card in the bottom of the stacks, and he gains a new card to refill his hand. With the second task, the player may take any number of car parts from one warehouse, provided he has enough spaces on his player board. If he cannot take all the car parts, he leaves the excess ones on the board. When a player gets certified in this department, he unlocks a car part space on his personal board, and he may also make use of this task. The player may perform this task only once, and he simply gains one car part voucher. Okay, let's move to assembly department to start producing some cars. What we see here is an assembly line for five different car types. On the right side, we see assembly spaces for each different car type, waiting for new car parts. Now, before players start to spend their shifts in this department, they first need to clean out all car parts from cars that have all the assembly spaces full, like here and here. All these car parts will be removed and will return back to the supply. Now the player may perform this task. With this task, the player provides any car part from his player board to any assembly space and produces a car. There are two restrictions here. There can never be two same car parts in the same assembly line. The second restriction is that if a car type we want to produce has some car parts upgraded, then the assembly line has to have these car parts first before we are able to provide not upgraded car parts. For example, to produce a blue car, I can only provide a pink car part from my player board. That's the first time so far in this explanation that the player needs a specific car part to spend from his player board. So that is a good time to talk about car part vouchers and recycling. Whenever a player needs to spend a specific car part, he can instead spend one of his car part vouchers. The newly gained car part has to be immediately used. You cannot spend a car part voucher to place a new car part on the player's board. Now let's talk about recycling. During their turn, players will always have three different car parts available in recycling to exchange with their own car parts in their personal board. They can exchange as many times as they wish, however, when they finish, there must be three different car parts remaining in recycling. After the car part is provided, the car must move following the red arrows. If there is another car in this space, then it is pushed and must move as well. If there are multiple red arrows from the space, the player chooses where to move. If again we move a car to another car's space, then we need to push this as well, and this continues until no other car is pushed. Last but not least, this space is refilled with a new car from the supply. Let's make another example. The player may spend another shift to provide another car part to any assembly space of the same or any other car type. The blue car type has now all its upgraded car parts already in its assembly spaces, so now the player may spend any other car part to produce it again. Now this car pushes this car, which pushes that car, and that car pushes the green car, which finally hits the tarmac. The empty space is again refilled, and now let's see what happens to the green car that has just exited the assembly line. When this happens, the player immediately gains the depicted production points, depending on the conveyor that delivered the car. If the delivered car is in demand, meaning its demand tile is on the board and there is an available speech token next to it, then the player immediately collects that token. Now this car moves to the test track. Each produced car moves to the test track, last in the row of cars behind the pace car. There can ever be only four cars behind the pace car. If another car is produced, then the car right behind the pace car is removed and goes back to the car supply, and the rest of the cars move to fill in the gap. At the end of the player's turn, if there are any demand tiles with no speech tokens next to them, as it happens here, then these demand tiles are set aside. The empty space is refilled with a new demand tile, the depicted number of speech tokens are placed next to it, and finally, the set-aside demand tile is reshuffled with the other tiles. If a player becomes certified in assembly department, he unlocks the fifth garage space on his player board. Now let's move to research and development department, where players acquire cars and upgrade car parts. With the first task, Claim Cars, a player can acquire cars that are currently in the test track. To do so, players must also have the corresponding designs for the cars they want to acquire, as well as enough empty garage spaces to place the acquired cars. Players first choose the cars they want to acquire, and then return the corresponding designs in the bottom of the central design stack. The cost in shifts depends on the position of the selected cars behind the pace car. For this example, these two selected cars will cost 4 shifts for that player. The player then takes the cars and places them on empty garage spaces on his player board, collecting immediately the bonus depicted in the bonus garage tile next to the garage space, and then flipping it over. For the last garage bonus tile, the player chooses any two of the depicted bonuses. After the player finishes acquiring cars, the pace car must move spaces equal to the number of cars acquired by the player, in this case, 2 spaces. Then the rest of the cars move to create a queue behind the pace car. With the task Upgrade the Design, a player upgrades a car part for a specific design. To perform this task, the player must have a design tile depicting a specific car part, but also have this car part available. Don't forget that car part vouchers and recycling may also be used. There are also some design tiles that don't depict a car part. These tiles may not be used for this task. The player places the car part from his player board to the corresponding design into any empty bonus space and collects it immediately. Then on the upgrade value track, the corresponding car part is moved up one level. Finally, the player flips the design tile, places it here, and then collects 2 production points as depicted on the tile itself. When you get certified in this department, you unlock the double upgraded design tile. This tile can be used only once by flipping it over during any future upgrade the design task. The difference will be that when using this tile is that the car part price marker will move 2 spaces to the right instead of just 1, if possible, of course. Then the player, on top of gaining the 2 production points for upgrading a design, he will also gain the points depicted above the car part value marker. So in this example, he will gain 5 production points. Finally, the marker is flipped to the other side depicting a striped line, indicating that this part has been double upgraded and it cannot be double upgraded again by any player. After players acquire cars or upgrade designs, they need to check if they have acquired the factory goal. If players in total have reached the number of acquired cars or the number of upgraded designs depicted in these tiles, they gain the speech marker from the corresponding tile, and if that was the last one, they remove the tile as well. A last thing that players need to be aware of when they interact with this department is that as soon as they have a specific model and an upgraded part for this model, they place the upgraded part above the garage. This is now a tested design. This could happen as soon as they upgrade the design or as soon as they acquire a new car. All the corresponding upgraded designs will move above the car immediately, and this will affect final scoring. Finally, let's see the administration department. Administration itself only has a training task, and when you get certified in this department, you gain 1 more speech token space on your player board. However, the player may choose 1 different department, and perform tasks spending shifts as if his pawn were there as well. If the player chooses the assembly department, remember to remove the car parts from full assembly sections before using the first shift. Now let's talk a bit more about Sandra. When it's her turn, as we said earlier, she will first evaluate the player or players with the least training in this department. So in this case, she will evaluate the purple and the yellow player. In the extreme example that all players are experts, she will still evaluate all of them. In her evaluation, she's trying to find if players meet specific criteria in order to penalize them. These criteria are different for each department and can all be found in Sandra's tile here. In research and development, evaluated players will be penalized if they have two or fewer upgraded designs. In assembly department, players will be penalized if they have two or fewer cars in their garages. In logistics, if they have two or fewer car parts on their player board. In design department, if they have two or fewer designs on their player boards. And finally, in administration, if they have been certified in two or fewer departments. The penalty is the same for all departments. The penalized player will lose a minimum of one production point plus another point for each point of difference between 5 and his shift marker. So if blue player was penalized, he would lose one production point, purple player would lose 3, and yellow and orange players would lose 6 production points. Ouch! So in other words, players try to train in order to avoid being evaluated by Sandra. If, however, they are evaluated, they try not to meet the criteria to be penalized, but if again they are penalized, they try to be high on banked shifts in order to minimize the penalty. After Sandra finishes with her evaluation, she performs a specific task which again is different for each department. In research and development, she moves the pace car and all queued cars behind it one space forward. In design, she shuffles the four rightmost designs and places them in the bottom of the central stack. In a two-player game, she shuffles the 8 rightmost tiles. Then the empty spaces are refilled as per normal. In the assembly department, she removes all car parts from all assembly spaces. In logistics, Sandra removes all but one car part from each warehouse. Finally, in administration, Sandra performs the end-of-week scoring, which we will now explain. When Sandra performs these tasks, the week comes to an end, and all players score production points as follows. For each car in their garages, players score one production point for each upgraded car part for that specific model. It doesn't matter who did the upgrades. On top of this scoring, and again for each car in their garages, players score one production point for each tested design they have for this model. In this example, the player has two tested designs for green cars, so each green car of that player will worth an additional 2 production points for that scoring. After you finish with this scoring, advance the weak marker one space to the right, unless it was already to the third space, which in this case, you just leave it in place. The last main game concept we haven't yet talked about are organizational meetings that take place in this area of the board. Now, when do these occur? A meeting is triggered whenever the pace car reaches or passes a striped space. Remember that the pace car moves whenever players acquire cars or when Sandra performs her R&D task. As soon as that happens, players take the meeting marker from R&D and place it here, so they remember that at the end of the current round's work phase, a meeting will take place. Meetings is a process where all players take turns playing their personal speech markers from on their board to speech marker spaces on performance goal cards and gain production points. The player turn order for this process is determined from the certification track order, again from right to left. So first player will be the yellow, then the orange, then the purple, and finally the blue player. Players will continue taking turns until they have all passed consecutively. Initially, the meeting starts with 4 performance goal cards. However, before the meeting concludes, all players must play one and only one performance goal card from their hand to the middle of the table. Players may place their markers to all of these cards as well. On his turn, a player either speaks and plays one of his markers or passes. When a player passes, he's not out of the meeting completely. When it's again his turn, he may re-enter and speak again. However, to be able to pass, you must have first played the personal goal card for the current meeting. So how are these performance goal cards played? When the player speaks, he may also play one of his cards in the middle of the table. After playing the card, the player may either proceed and place a speech marker on the just played card or not play a speech marker at all this turn. Speaking just to play the performance goal card is absolutely allowed. When players speak, they must place their marker to the highest empty space of any performance goal card, meaning the space with the largest multiplier. Now, what are these cards? These cards describe criteria and grant production points depicted below to the player as soon as he places his marker. The multiplier on the space acquired is how many times the player may satisfy the criteria to multiply the award in production points. For example, this card awards the player 4 production points if he has a green car in his garage. By placing my speech marker in the double multiplier means I can score this twice provided I have at least 2 green cars on my player board. I currently have 3 green cars on my player board, however the double multiplier enables me to score up to twice, so I get 8 production points. Now it's the next player's turn. Now last but not least, it is also allowed to acquire a space even if you don't gain any production points for doing so. When all players have consecutively passed, then the meeting is over and you should perform the following steps. Players take back all the played personal speech tokens from the performance goal cards and place them next to their board. If at this point players have a general speech token next to their board, they return it now to the supply and place a new personal speech token on their board. All performance goal cards on the board and the ones played by the players during the meeting are now discarded. At this moment, all players should have 2 performance goal cards remaining in their hand. They will choose one of them and will play it face down in administration. If playing with less than 4 players, add the missing cards from the supply. Then, flip these cards face up and all players should get 2 cards from the supply to bring their hand back to 3 cards. Finally, return the meeting marker to the R&D space and forward the production cycle marker 1 space to the right, unless it was already in space 3. Now let's see how this game ends. We have 2 tracks, we have a weak track and a production cycle track. Both of these tracks can have a value of maximum 3. Now, if the sum of these 2 values in the tracks is 5, then complete the current round and instead of going to the next one, perform scoring and end the game. And this takes us to the final scoring explanation. First, players gain production points by activating objectives in the final goal tile. The tile offers 3 different objective goals that the player may activate for himself by placing a personal speech marker from on the board on the objective itself. If the player has generic markers next to his board, he may also use these. For example, the first objective here grants the player 7 production points if the player has 3 cars of the same model in his garages. Player turn order here is not applicable. All players may choose the same objectives. Then players gain 1 production point for each banked shift, for each personal speech token on their board, and for each car part voucher, and for each book remaining. Then players gain production points for each car in their garages. Green cars worth 2 production points, blue cars 3, grey cars 4, red cars 5, and finally black cars worth 6 production points. Next players score production points for training in each department. The player with the highest training gains 5 production points, the second one 3, and the third one 1 production point. In case there are multiple markers in the same space, the tiers are awarded from top to bottom. So here the purple player is first, the blue player is second, and the orange player is third. Finally, players gain production points for each one of their tested designs, depending on the position of the corresponding car part in the carport price track. After final scoring, the player with the most production points is declared the winner. In case there is a tie, there are three tiebreakers. First, it's the player with the most cars, then the player with the most tested designs, and finally the player with the most banked shifts. If there is still a tie, then all tied players share their victory. And that's the end for today's video for Vitala Serda's Kanban EV. If you liked that video and want to see more, please subscribe to my channel. If I made any mistakes in the rules, please write it in the comment section, and until next time, have fun and play more board games.